evolution at Galapagos. So some people ask, where does Galapagos, the name Galapagos, come from? And then the nice story, which is not really true, but that is what we normally use, is what we do at Galapagos is study human disease in a dish, and we look at the phenotype of cells and how they are influenced by the biology of a disease or factors that are playing a role in disease. So what we're looking at is at the phenotype of cells, just like Darwin looked at the beaks of finches, at the phenotype of those birds on the Galapagos Islands. So that's where the name Galapagos comes from. At least that's what we like to tell. So what I'm going to talk about is indeed about cell cultures at Galapagos and how that evolved actually from simple 2D cultures to more complex 3D cultures. And we actually use a lot of the Mimetos plates and technologies for that. And also give you a reason why we're actually doing that. And also a little bit of a critical look at it. So we are really a pioneering company, so we're trying to do novel things like those 3D cultures in the interest of patients. So we are a daring company and we care for these patients. So we now have the slogan, we discover, we dare, we care. And one of the things that is how the company started is about with identifying targets. Actually, we started 20 years ago as a target discovery company, try to identify novel targets in different disease areas. Actually, very many. And since then we grew, and we developed actually first-in-class drugs against those targets. And as Paul mentioned, in 2020, we will bring the first drug to the market. It's a JAK1 selective inhibitor called filgotinib. And we have done this actually by partnerships. And now, because of the first drug, we are building now a commercial organization and we can take programs to the market ourselves. So this is actually a full circle organization now. And we're probably not the biggest biotech company, it depends how you qualify that. But we are now, when I joined 15 years ago, we were about 60 people. Today we are about 1,000 people. Those 1,000 people are working on a very rich pipeline. Filgotinib, I already mentioned. It's a drug that inhibits JAK1 and can be applied not only in rheumatoid arthritis, but in different inflammatory diseases. I'll come back to those inflammatory diseases. One of them is IBD. We're also very active in the field of fibrosis, where we're in phase 3 with an autotaxin inhibitor. We're active in OA with an ADAMTS5 inhibitor in phase 2. And we have over 20 research programs ongoing. And in those research programs, you use a lot of these cell culture models that I'm going to talk about. In 2019, we had about 40 clinical trials ongoing. It's one of the reasons why we are so many people now. 2 years ago, research was the biggest organization. Now, clinical development is far bigger. Half the company is basically clinical development. So, again, coming back to the name Galapagos, looking at phenotypes, and that's explained in this slide. So what we try to do is recapitulate the disease in a dish. And we use human primary cells for that. We did that already 20 years ago when everybody was still using cell lines. We already realized if you really want to find the real targets that are playing an important role in disease, we have to work with primary cells derived from patients, preferably if possible. So all in human cells. And we had a proprietary library, an adenoviral library of knockdown construct of shRNAs. We actually And that is an array library with which we can knock down individual genes in cells. So we can culture these cells in those dishes, 96 well plates, or sometimes even 384 well plates, add a virus that knocks down one individual gene, and look what happens to the phenotype. Again, what Darwin did, we're doing in the lab as well. We look at the phenotype of these cells, how do they change, and do they go from a disease phenotype to a normal, healthy phenotype? In that case, if you figure out which knockdown construct that is, it could represent an interesting target that we could maybe drug with small molecules. So we're not doing RNAi therapy, that might be in the near future, but we're using this as a tool to identify targets that are amenable for small molecule therapies. And we do this in high throughput. So we have the robotics, and we can screen thousands of viruses. At the moment, the library is about 20,000 viruses big. We're going to expand that actually to probably close to 100,000 viruses in the near future. But that's how we can do that in a highly automated way and create lots of data points and identify those targets. So it's a combination actually of this novel cell biology, RNAi, and high throughput screening that actually makes us unique. There are very few companies who can actually do this, especially in human primary cells. 20 years ago, everybody was scared to do primary cells. They thought they were highly variable, it was difficult to culture, especially in high quantities. Can you do experiments with them? But we showed you can actually do it. And that's shown here on this slide, where we have so many different cell culture models in different disease processes. All these assays have been set up in our company and have been screened with our RNAi library. Truly unique, no company in the world has this. So this relies on human primary cells, and we do not always have human primary cells available. So sometimes we can get primary lung epithelial cells, and we can grow them on 2D, and that's actually how we've been doing most of our screens. And for example, it's pretty easy to get primary epithelial cells from the lung and the skin. So we have done a lot of programs around that. But it's actually pretty difficult, at least until a few years ago, to obtain human primary cells from the colon or the intestine. So we were interested in IBD, as I mentioned, it's one of our key areas of research, where we wanted to look at the interaction between the epithelium of the colon together with the immune system, the dendritic cells. And we didn't have human primary cells, so we used CARCO2 cells, which is a kind of a tumor cell line of the colon. And we could grow them on an insert together with dendritic cells. And then we could look at if we, so actually we then triggered these dendritic cells with E. coli to mimic what's happening actually in IBD patients, where the immune system responds to commensal bacteria. What happened then if you trigger those dendritic cells, they start to produce factors that induce inflammation of the colon, and they start to produce factors that we can measure. And we could knock down individual genes in these cells and see which gene is involved in the response to these activated dendritic cells. So that was a very labor-intensive, extremely expensive assay. Those inserts, transwell inserts, are very costly. Plus, we're using this CARCO2 cell line, which I personally didn't like, but it was the only way to do it. There were no human primary epithelial cells available until the organoids. And that's where we invested in recently, is can we culture colon organoids, intestinal organoids, because that was the only source of human primary colon cells still today. And in the meantime, we also started to investigate how to set up these colon cells in a 3D culture using the Mimetos technology, which we really liked because you can really grow them in their natural structures, and you can combine them with flow or extracellular matrix, etc., without a membrane, and I think that's extremely important, that there is no membrane in the system. So we have investigated a lot of in the organoids, we have investigated a lot in the carco, in the mimetic system, and at the moment we're actually trying to see if we can put this into that to replace actually the carcos that we're showing here. So this is the system, the mimetic system, where we use a three-lane system, where we can grow cells in one lane, so the cockatoos, and they form a nice tube, together with an extracellular matrix, and then perfusion medium, for example. And that shows that is then shown here. The cells form a nice tubal, together with extracellular matrix. And over time, this becomes a leak-tight tubal. So we can do tear measurements, and you see that after 4 or 5 days, you get a leak-tight tubal. So you get a real colon in a dish. And we can use that to study that. And this was done as part of a Marie Curie grant where several PhD students worked on, Claudia Beaurivage and Elena Namaska, together with Mimetos and the University of Sheffield and the Galapagos. They worked on this, and that was recently published. So this is actually some images of those CARCO2 cultures in the system. And what you can see is you get a nice organization of those cells, actin expression, E-cation expression. But if you then include an inflammatory trigger, some inflammatory cytokines, you see that this becomes disorganized, and actually they lose the barrier function. So they become permeable because they actually get destroyed. Something very typical in IBD. So we can really mimic IBD in a dish. We can culture a human colon using these cells. They polarize nicely, they have certain markers, and they have a barrier function which is destroyed in an inflammatory condition. So can we identify targets in this system? Yes, we can, we think. Although not in high throughput, that's too labor intensive probably. But we can use our adenovirus to deliver shRNA constructs, so almost all the cells get transduced when we use a reporter gene. And then we knock down genes that are relevant for inflammation, like MyD88. When we use a knockdown construct for that, we see a strong reduction in the messenger RNA for that particular gene. And when we use a RAL-A knockdown, we see a strong reduction of RAL-A. So we can knock down genes that are relevant in inflammation. And what's interesting, if we do that, we also lower the production of CCL20 by these CAECO cells. And CCL20 is an important factor in IBD. So we can nicely identify or validate targets in this system. And not only that, we can also use compounds in this system. This is an NF-kappa B inhibitor, and with increasing doses, we see an increasing inhibition of the CCL20 production or IP10 production, and also restoration of the barrier function. So this is a very nice system that we like to use for target tests of target identification, or at least target validation in lower throughput, and for compound testing, not only to see if we can find drugs, but often we have the question, what is this drug actually doing? And this system allows us to do that. What's happening to these cells? What pathways are activated or inhibited by these compounds? So as I mentioned, this is the CAECO cell, and we have also invested time in the organoids, and we want to see if we can combine the organoid system with the Mimetos technology. And we have invested in the past a lot in organoid cultures because we were very active in the cystic fibrosis field, and the cystic fibrosis organoids from CF patients are used to actually see if drugs will be active in the patient or not. So we had the organoid technology already in-house for CF, but we also developed this for IBD. And we can culture colon organoids from healthy donors, actually together with dendritic cells. What you actually see here is a dendritic cell that tries to move and feel into the lumen of this colon, exactly what dendritic cells are supposed to do. And we can measure inflammatory responses in these cell cultures. And as you see, if you use an inflammatory cocktail of cytokines, of inflammatory cytokines, we can, over time and at different concentrations, increase the production, for example, of CCL20 in these organoids, like we also have seen for the Kako cells. And we can also inhibit these responses, this time for IP10. When we use a compound in combination with these organoids, we see a reduction in inflammatory cytokine production. So this is our colon organoid culture, so not on a Mimetos plate, and we can use this to mimic IBD as well. And not only that, also these organoids can be transduced with adenovirus. We get very good efficiency of transduction, and we can actually edit a certain gene, in this case target A, and what we see is that a gene gets edited from 540 base pairs into two bands, showing that we get good editing, and around 20 to 30% of the cells are edited using the adenoviral CRISPR system in these organoids, which is quite remarkable, I think. There are not many papers showing this. So we have the Mimetos technology, where we can use Kako and culture them into tubes. And we have the organoid technology with human primary colon cells. And can we combine them? And that's what Claudia has been trying to do. And these are the first results that look very promising. These are these colon organoid-derived cells on a Mimetos plate, and they're nicely organized, express E-cadherin, they express aspirin, the actin is nicely organized, and are even mucin-positive cells in it. So they differentiate into different cell types in this system. It's not yet leak tight. That is one of the issues we're working on, but that is ongoing. And the biggest aim, and that's ongoing as well, is to co-culture this with immune cells. And we already have some results, but we still need to work on that, is where we can co-culture this colon derived from organoids with, for example, macrophages, human macrophages. And then we can mimic the whole thing where we started with, and that was the co-culture of Kako and an insert together with dendritic cells or macrophages. So this is how the colon culture system evolved within Galapagos, with the aim of working with really human primary cells in combination with the immune system. I'll show you a few examples quickly about other cultures that we think are important for our research and for developing drugs. One is blood vessels. Mimetos has shown this already many times themselves. We worked actually with microvascular endothelial cells, primary. So this is not a cell line, but these are primary cells. And indeed, we can grow them also in a tube, and they express certain markers that are typical for endothelial cells. And the question was, can we induce sprouting? And so together with Mimetos, we set this up, and indeed, we can induce sprouting. So you culture the tube, the blood vessel tube here, and so you can look at this way, and then you see the sprouting, or you can look from the side, and then you see it going this way, just like Mariana showed as well, of growing microvasculature towards tissues and tumor cells. So we see this happening. So this shows that the whole system is mimicking what's happening in vivo. And the question we had is, can we indeed also here induce a disease phenotype? So we're interested in vasculitis, we're interested in what destruction of these vessels in scleroderma. So we exposed these cultures to TGF-beta, which is a factor in scleroderma, and TNF-alpha, which is a factor in inflammation and vasculitis. And we see indeed that if you include those factors, that you inhibit the sprouting, and basically almost collapses. And actually, together with Mimetos, we developed a system where we can quantify the sprouting here. And you see that these factors have an impact on the sprouting. So this is a very useful system for us to see, first of all, to test drugs that are involved in vasculitis and scleroderma, and maybe even do target discovery, but we haven't tried that yet. The other disease we're interested in is polycystic kidney disease. We have a large target discovery program going on there. And so we want to mimic the kidney in the dish. And one of the things we have done is working with Ton Rabling at LUMC, developing mini nephrons. So this is using inducible pluripotent stem cells. And we can grow them in a like an organoid, more or less. And when we add forskolin to these mini nephrons, they start to form cysts. You see these white blobs of cells. So that's typical of PKD. But when we use compounds actually from our own collection, we can reduce the formation of cysts induced by forskolin. And we also can quantify that with all these kind of high content imaging algorithms. And so we have now identified a couple of compounds that are active in this model. And actually one of those compounds is currently, has also been tested in mice. And there we see also similar effects, PKD knockout mice that develop PKD-like symptoms. And actually one of these compounds is going to be in the clinic very soon. So again, this is what I was showing was an organoid-like system. And then we also want to see if we can use this in the organoplate of mimetas, where we can then combine, make real tubes, like the kidney, like the proximal tube of a kidney. And also here we see nice tube formation that we can study. One of the things that one of the other PhD students has done in the Marie Curie Fellowship is Sindhu Naik. And she can actually measure the length of cilia. And it's known that the cilia length is affected in PKD, for example. So we can now study the length. We can actually quantify this and see if we have compounds that can affect cilia length and maybe therefore also affect polycystic kidney disease. So these are the examples I want to show you of 3D systems that we are employing at Galapagos. And we think through these systems, we can identify targets that are really involved in diseases, are not an artifact of cell lines or other conditions. And the system can also be used to better test drugs, understand the mode of action, their potency, etc. So this all looks very nice, but it's also a lot of work. And we learn a lot, that's not the problem, but we use this because we do have a need for disease-relevant models and assays. And they're not always there. As I said, we need primary cells because we really believe that we have to work with primary cells, and the organoids and the proximal tubal cells from iPSC cells, for example, can help with that, because otherwise you have to work with cell lines. And as I've shown, we have evolved from a static 2D systems to dynamic 3D co-cultures. However, the biologists are really enthusiastic about this, but we are a company and we have to also be realistic. We're not answering an academic question here about why are the cilia shorter or longer. No, we want to make sure that the cilia are functional using a compound. And the problem is all these systems at the moment is, do they really give a different or novel answer to the question we have in drug discovery and development, and a better answer than just simple 2D models? And that actually is, I think, in this field, something we really have to pay attention to, because for many people in our company, that's not clear. So they will always ask the question, Richard, why are you doing this complex stuff? Does it really give a different answer? and that still needs to be addressed. Can we show that if you test a compound in a Keiko versus a 3D co-culture, as I've shown here, you get different results, and that the result you get from the complex co-culture is really benefiting the patient rather than the finding in the Keiko? At the moment, we don't know. There's no evidence. In the CF field, we do see that these kind of these organoid cultures can contribute to the development of drugs for patients, but in cancer possibly also, because you're also there, like CF, working with genetic components. But in IBD, where this is not really a genetic disease, as far as we know, we don't see it. So in the disease area, but also in toxicology, people make a lot of claims that testing a compound in a 3D co-culture system is better than in a 2D system with a cell line. You still have to prove that these drugs are, when they're toxic in the 3D system, will be toxic in the patient or not. And that I think in this field is the real challenge, at least from the viewpoint of a company. Thank you.
Thanks, Richard, for a great lecture and some important side notes at the end as well. Can I have some first questions from the audience? Hans.
Richard, great presentation, especially your concluding remarks, because that triggers me as well, the validation of it all. You know, and we all know, or we hope, that in 10 years from now, this will be standard technology everywhere in drug development. What could we do to help you at Galapagos to convince your colleagues that a parallel experiment should be done or to do something instead of? Could the government help you, for example, there, or EMA, if you would get a 1 year quicker registration approval on a development which has taken this into account? What would help you to motivate your organization?
Now, what you have to do is make the right translation and one of the things I think that the first step that needs to be done is test a lot of compounds in standard animal models for IBD, for example. Test them also in the Keiko system, test them also in the co-culture system, as I've shown here, in organoids, etc., and show that there's really a difference and that compounds that have been active in animal models and active in patients indeed came up in your co-culture system and not in the Keiko system, and the ones that failed the other way around. And that's what you have to show, this translation from the lab to the patient. And that step is probably too big, so you have to put in the animal in between, I think. And especially for efficacy, that will be really great. Toxicology, people will still always use the mouse to test whether the compound is toxic.
Do you think that academia should do that kind of work, or the private sector, the companies? Because it takes you time, it takes you money, it takes you energy.
Yeah.
So how can somebody help?
I think most companies will say this is an academic question. They have to show it. Yeah.
Just to follow up on that, thank you very much, Pedro. What do you think about the use of different organs? Because when you are talking about toxicology, we want to know what effect is in the liver or in the heart, for example. So what about this idea of using different organs on chips and connecting them together? Be of course more complex, but it might help to show the toxicology in a human disease.
Yeah. Now I think there is value in combining the liver and the kidney and other organs for toxicology purposes, especially with regard to metabolism of compounds and then how these compounds have an effect on tissues. Because that is at the moment actually not, at least not in vitro, we cannot test that. That is one of the things we have to do in animals. So if you really want to replace animals, what the EU likes to do, there I see a value of in toxicology in combining those tissues in one system. Yeah. Yeah.
Any further questions?
Yeah.
And just to follow up on first question, probably the IBD model is one of the most difficult also because there is one component that is missing, in my opinion, that is the microbial. Basically, we can have the organoids, or that are possibly more similar to the in vivo condition. We can add the immune component, but what is still missing, and is missing both in the cartilage and the organoids, is the microbes that populate the intestine. So only if we manage to get that component in the system, probably we can measure the differences.
Yeah. No, I think you're right. I was talking about genetic disease like CF and cancer, which, it will help you in predicting how compounds will behave. And in the IBD, it's indeed probably the microenvironment rather than a mutation. And then the microbial component that we need to add. And it would then be interesting to see that microbial collection from one donor, a healthy donor, and an IBD donor, whether that will impact your system, whether you see differences in the phenotypes, and then indeed use that to screen. Yeah, that would be really fantastic if that is possible. Yeah.